Hello everyone, we're here at Devoxx 2014 and I'm here with Chet and wait, you're Roman.
Pourquoi?
Oh, good, good. And with Nick. And you guys came out recently of the keynote that you did, and this was about material design. So people might have heard of it, but why don't you tell us how we got to material design? What problem is it trying to solve, and why do developers do even need to care about this?
Wow. Let me take a swing of this first. Yeah, okay, let's take that from the top. What is material design? So material design is Google's attempt at providing a design language, I guess you could call it, like a holistic design thing, to solve designing for the range of platforms that are out there. So everyone's trying to access your services from like little tiny screens on your watches, phones, tablets, TVs, cars, and whoever, you know, whatever else they end up putting some smarts into. So we needed some way to make those experiences kind of consistent, so you can like learn how to use them on one screen and use it elsewhere, and that's material design.
And that's not just Android, right? This is trying to...
Absolutely, yeah. So not just a variety of form factors, but different platforms as well.
So Android and the web, basically, and Polymer would be the project that addresses that in terms of the implementation.
Right. So in the keynote today, we were talking about both of those platforms, saying what material design is overall, what are the design factors going into it, and the things that we're going for with the design, and then talking about the specific implementations on both Polymer and Android.
So before we get to why developers should care about this and what it means to them, how did we get there? I mean, you mentioned like, it's not the first time we talk about themes. We're actually talking about something similar in previous years here. So how does this change? And talk us about maybe Holo or maybe about Kennedy on the web.
Yeah.
And I mean, this is a multi-year effort.
This didn't just like come down from the mountain on tablets saying here is like material design. This has been like an ongoing kind of evolution, I guess. If you kind of rewind a couple of years, 4 or 5 years maybe, a lot of products in Google and other companies, I think, kind of evolved on their own. So you might have a team who are building, you know, your Android app, and a team who are building the web app, and a team who are building whatever, your iOS app, or something. And those would kind of like exist in isolation. So we just evolved to this point where all these experiences were their own things, and they kind of weren't really coherent. So that was like, you know, across platforms, and the same between apps, even from one company, so even from Google. Like if you use something like YouTube and then something else like Gmail, it might not, you know, look and feel the same. They had their own kind of foibles and interaction patterns and so on. So you couldn't like learn on one and then apply it to another. So you mentioned Kennedy. That was an initiative we had, I think, back in 2011, where Larry Page kind of like set a mandate saying, hey, this is a problem. We need to kind of make our properties more consistent. So we set about like a big kind of redesign, I guess, of updating all of our web properties to look and feel the same. So that's when you got the kind of, you know, lots more white space and like big red buttons saying compose and so on. That was the Kennedy look and feel. But that mostly applied to the web properties. It didn't really kind of apply to some of the other things. Like at the same time, Android was evolving like its own Holo design language. So they're kind of like going in their own direction. So I think material design is like a evolution of that kind of Kennedy effort, like to grow up and like try and provide a kind of complete design language for all the different platforms.
So is material design done? I mean, are we working just on the implementation details?
You guys are done now, right? Like, you're done, that's it, framework's finished?
We're done for now. Is design ever complete? No, I think a lot of the fundamentals are there in terms of the design aspects, like what the consistent approach that they have to these things are, the fundamentals of, you know, we have the ideas of paper and ink and how things interact with the user, and then the implementation, sort of the V1 implementation of that in Lollipop, envisioning a lot of the fundamentals, the plumbing layer of actually making the stuff work. I think we can continue to iterate over it, but those I would see as being refinements on top of material design as opposed to implementing other core pieces.
So you've been trying very hard not to use like gibberish from you know, designer world.
Designer speak.
Yeah, maybe you can give us an example of what that would be.
I think, if you look at the spec, as we call it, if you go to google.com/design, /spec. There's like this whole big document detailing, you know, these rules of material design, these organizing principles, and it uses quite a lot of designers. I think it's focused at designers. It says things like a coherent design system, and uses things like rational uses of space and. What was the one you pulled me up on before?
Using visual rhythm?
Visual rhythm, I think, yeah. So one. Words like that.
Right. So do I need to read that? I'm a developer. I don't get me wrong. I want to have like engaging apps and people to understand what the app's supposed to do and look around. And for I understand design is important, but do I really need to go through all that?
We might have different answers here. I say yes.
I would say yes.
I think you're touching on a really important point. I think... you get like a much better product when you have designers and developers working close together, and you have these tight like feedback loops. It shouldn't just be like design happens here and it gets thrown over the wall, and then development tries to work out what that actually means and develop something. I think that you get a better product when you work closely together. And I think working closely together needs a shared vocabulary, so you're actually talking about the same thing. So yes, it's important to read it. You can laugh at the kind of terms and the touchy-feely concepts sometimes. But like, I don't know, getting some of the vocabulary to say, hey, what do you mean by this thing? What are you trying to actually do here? What's the vocabulary? Yeah, I think it helps in that. And I think like vice versa, I think designers should peruse the developer documentation and try and understand the limitations of what people are trying to build, so they know when to push and when to what's just not possible and so on. I think it's got to be a conversation.
So maybe let's get into some of the details for the developers. So you want to maybe talk about Android and how some of the main principles actually are implemented and things that are changing. Is it just an evolution, like brand new APIs? This is the new material design package and a bag of APIs. How does that work?
It's not like fundamentally new stuff. It's still a standard Android program. What we did was add capabilities to the platform to handle things like real-time shadows, APIs to handle opting into those capabilities. So if you want to actually boost a view in Z to give it real-time shadows, we added APIs for you to do that. The way that I envision what we did in the toolkit team in this release was that we looked at the design team sort of waving their hands and saying, material design, we want all these, sort of general grand capabilities and this consistent, design language, blah, blah, blah. And then we would go in and tease out the bits that meant for the platform. Okay, when they're talking about this, what they really mean is they need the rendering system to be able to handle real-time shadows to 60 frames a second. When they're talking about this, what they mean is they need the theming system to be able to dynamically colorize assets so that we can brand applications. And so then our job in the release was to then implement those capabilities and add those APIs for developers to then opt into those capabilities in their applications. I think that was all I was doing with that one.
I think one of my favorite things about it is that I think we've enabled a lot of backwards compatibility behavior as well.
Oh, so exactly. I wanted to get to that. Absolutely.
So there's some awesome new work in the framework to do things like real-time shadows and so on. But you can still do a lot of the material stuff on older platforms as well. So I think we put a lot of effort into things like the app compat library in particular. I think is a really good job for helping you to build material UIs. So you can get this kind of graceful degradation, right? You can only have a single design because you don't want to have to maintain two designs, two code paths. And just have it kind of like do one thing on like a newer platform, which might do fancier shadows, and it might fall back to using like a baked-in background or using something like card view, also in the support library, which will give you the real shadow implementation on a new Lollipop device, but then it'll give you a reasonable approximation on an older device. So I really like the way that the kind of backwards compatibility has been thought about when making the new APIs.
So as part of Lollipop, a number of applications that come with the system actually were rewritten or upgraded to material design.
Anyone you would want to
point out, or are these good examples of things that should serve as inspiration for developers?
Okay, so I think one of my favorite, it's not an app per se, but like I think the system UI, I think the way that notifications work, especially on the lock screen, I think is brilliant. I find it really fun, like where you see the notifications on the lock screen, you can instantly like expand them and get them to the different states and interact with the action straight away.
There's a lot of subtle things too in your interaction. As you move the shade up and down, you're seeing things sort of subtly fade and move around. If you look really closely, you can actually see the shadows reacting in real time, because, you know, as you move things around on the screen, they're changing their position relative to the light source, the virtual light source that's casting the shadows. But you see other subtle things like animated icons actually moving around as you're moving the shade up and down. Just a lot more rich interaction to the user about what's actually going on in the system.
Yeah, also I think the new Play Newsstand application did some really, really nice animations. Chet's favorite topic.
Yeah, activity transition stuff.
Do you want to talk about animation in general?
I always want to talk about animation.
I know you do, but specifically...
How long do we have?
You have 30 seconds. That's about it. But no, seriously, I mean, again, you know, why should you have them and why should you not abuse them, probably?
So... I like animations, but mostly targeted towards a specific reason, which is helping the user understand what's going on. I think there's two main uses of that. One is to highlight something to the user of information they need to be aware of, so like a pulsating button on the screen when they need to be aware that this is the default action that's going to take place. The thing that you're going to see more of in this release is transitioning the user, so helping them understand a flow through an otherwise very complicated system of UIs, right? So as they go from window to window, from activity to activity, or fragment to fragment in their application, you can be exposing them to seriously complicated user interfaces. How can you help them understand how they got here, where they came from, what they're supposed to do about it now? And one of those ways is by using animations to transition them. Not just pop that old UI out and pop the new one in, but actually share elements between the UIs so they understand what those shared elements are and what happened to the elements that no longer are there, what happened to the new elements that just faded in. Mm-hmm. So that, I think, is the really powerful use of animations, not just to make things look blingy on the screen, but to actually help the user be more connected to the application experience.
And how does that fit into Lollipop specifically and the APIs? And
so one of the big new API areas that we enabled was activity transitions, the idea in material design of being able specifically to do these transitions so that, let's take an example, you're in a music application, you have a list of albums, and you want to click on one of the albums and then see the songs associated with the album. Obviously, you're probably going to have similar artwork for the album in both of those pages there, or both of those activity windows. So as you click on the album, maybe we can actually share that element between them, and we can share some text as well, whatever the shared elements are between those two UIs, and then fade in and out the other elements that go away or come into being. The activity transitions API builds on the transitions API that we had in KitKat, but makes it available for overall activities. So now you can say, okay, when I launch the following activity, here's the animation that I want you to run, and here are the shared elements that you're going to automatically animate into place for me.
Do you want to talk about the theming?
Yeah.
I think I love the idea of having all of that being handled by... Lollipop, do you want to tell folks about how it works?
The coloring and so on?
Yes, the coloring.
Yeah. So for a long time, we've been talking about how you can use color to have like a branding and have your identity and personality in the application. But it was kind of a pain in the ass to implement. You kind of had to go to these websites and like input these in my colors and download a couple of hundred assets and XML files and dump them into your app and so on. And if you wanted a couple of colors and you different looks of the screen, you'd have to repeat that. So it was kind of... a lot of work for developers. The framework team have done a huge amount of work to basically take grayscale assets in the system, bake them into the system, and then at runtime tint them. So you just provide the coloring information as like as simple attributes in your theme, and we'll take care of doing all the coloring for you, which is really, really cool.
And then similarly, you can also tint things at runtime. So you can bake them into your theme and say, here's what I want my overall theme to look like. Here's the colors that you should use for my overall application, but let's say you go into some sub-activity in your application, you want this screen to be colorized according to the information that's in that bitmap.
Yeah.
Then you'd go to something like the palette library that's now in support library in Lollipop, and you'd extract information from the bitmap to get certain dominant colors, and then you can dynamically tint the assets along the way. So not in your theme, because this is at runtime, but dynamically actually call set tint and say, use this color for the current background color.
A good example of that is, I think, the contacts app on Lollipop, or I think we just launched the new SMS app, messaging app, for other devices as well. And that kind of like, it's a utility app, it doesn't really have a strong brand, so it kind of like gets itself out of the way and just picks a color from the contact. So like you contact their photo, it'll pick out a distinct color and it'll colorize all the icons and so on. So you get this kind of like immersive, kind of rich feel. Like each contact feels different. You get like, you know, by glancing at it, you get a different kind of feeling, which is really, really like a rich UI. I like it.
Right. So as Lollipop is being shipped to a number of devices as we speak, What should developers do now? I mean, should they be worried that their app's going to be obsolete and it will show like real soon because there is a big difference, or should they gradually upgrade, and then what resources should they be looking at?
Yeah, this is an interesting one because it's an evolution of Holo, but it looks quite different to Holo. So it's going to be quite hard, I think, to implement like half your app in Material and half your app in an older design. So I think it's going to be a kind of thing where you take your time and sit back and work out the major wins, like how do we adopt the visuals, and then how do we use the idea of surfaces to in our UI to get the right shadows and so on.
And then implementing more animations, but I think there is a sliding scale of activity that they could do in their activities. in terms of, okay, so first thing is you opt into the theme. If you're only running on L, you opt in the Material theme and you get a bunch of stuff for free. If you're using the Spora library, you opt into the App Compat theme. And again, when you're running on L, then you would get all the Material theme stuff for free. And that's going to give you sort of the standard widgets and colors. And then you can build on that from there. You can say, well, which of my assets look slightly out of place in the new world? What do I want to do about those assets? What animations can I use so I no longer have jump cut experiences in the user flow?
Yeah, so I'd say like now is the right time to start working on your Material app, because I guess there's going to be an expectation bar, right? When users get Lollipop on the device and they start seeing the smooth animations and the subtle use of shadows, it's going to raise their expectation bar. Like, this is what an app should look and feel like. So I say definitely developers should get on it now.
And with compat libraries frameworks that exist before, you can, if you're not targeting L, you can still pretty much do almost all of it. It's probably harder, but it's not impossible if you really want to get to that look and feel.
You can get a lot of the way there.
Okay.
As for resources as to where they should go, on our developer site, so d.android.com, click through to the blog. There's been a series of posts about implementing Material design of late. And also under the training section, there's a section on implementing Material design as well.
Okay, so all developers should learn probably about it. Read this. I haven't read it. Uh-huh. I'll be honest, but I will. And everybody should just probably try Lollipop as a user and get inspired and start building.
Enter the Material world.
Enter the Material world. Oh, okay.
There we go.